cuta wuta ta gani ta kukan ma.
He had this bashfulness. They described his haya, and listen to the words. They described his haya, his bashfulness, like a virgin woman behind her veil. Today, if you have haya, especially amongst the Arab, and I know, haram miskin and the midri shubah. ما بيحكي مصطوط ما بيحكي مدري أحنا أجمعين. No. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, he spoke only when he had to speak. And he had this haya, he had this shyness, this bashfulness. Today we think if you're proud and arrogant that this man is strong. La wallah. And don't get mixed up either. Don't think that because he had haya and bashfulness that the man was weak in any way, shape or form. A'udhu billah. Because the Sahaba, they described Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and these are the men who gave their life. Sahaba are describing Rasulullah and they said, wallahi, when we were on the battlefield and the fighting got so intense that we couldn't fight anymore, khalas, we couldn't lift our swords, the fighting was too much, Sahaba got too tired, they said, wallahi, we would put our armor down, run behind the back of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just to take a breath of air, just to take a moment of relaxation, while he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continued fighting. The greatest Nabi, the greatest father, the greatest leader, the greatest warrior, the greatest commander, the greatest in every aspect of life, wallahi, is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Your prophet. And what's more amazing is the love that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he had for the ummah. Wallahi, my brothers, wallahi, this is not Hollywood. This is not Bollywood. Wallahi, I'm not trying to move your emotions. I'm not trying to impress you with my speech. Wallahi, wallahi, uqsam billah, I take an oath by Allah. Rather, I speak to you because I just want, for once in your life, I want you to really, really, really think and imagine your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Love, wallahi, no movie, no song, no poem, no Shakespeare, no nothing has ever displayed a love like the love that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, never mind what he had for Sahaba. For you and I, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, in the authentic hadith, she's saying, I was spending the night with my husband, and really I want you to imagine, put your shoes in the mother of Aisha now. She says, I was spending the night with Rasulullah, he was spending it at my house. And we know Rasulullah was married to 9. So he would see Aisha once every 9 nights, so it's already a rare occasion for him. And Aisha is saying, he was spending the night in my house, and very rare, you know, he was always concerned, mahmoom, fakir, yani concerned. She says he was spending the night in my house and he was smiling, he was in a good mood. Imagine, wallahi, this hadith. So Aisha says, you know, wallahi, I'm so jealous of him. She says, you know, look, he was happy in my house. So she says, hey, why not take advantage of the moment? So she says, O Prophet of Allah, can you make dua for me, Aisha? Can you make dua for me? Imagine you had this exclusivity with him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So of course, being her husband, being the Nabi, being Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, listen to the words. He raises his hands and he makes dua for his wife Aisha, your mother. He says, O Allah, forgive Aisha. Forgive her past, her present, and her future. Oh Allah, forgive the sins that she knows about and the sins that she doesn't know about. Imagine this dua from Rasulullah. So Aisha, when she hears the hadith, she heard the dua, she began. became so happy in the hadith, she chuckled, she giggled, she was so happy. Imagine the happiness. You know, wallahi, forgive me for using a trivial example. Some of us, one of us, he buys a new car, and the happiness in his heart, wallahi, he starts driving around Edmonton all day long. He'll visit a friend he hasn't seen in 20 years. Well, I was in the neighborhood, then I thought I'd say hello. Who is a liar? He just wants you to see his car. But because he's so happy, he wants the world to see this little happiness and joy that he has. So Aisha just had the greatest dua made for her, and unfortunately it was in her house, there was no one to see or hear. So, you know, she was laughing so much in the hadith, she fell in the laps of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he hugged her. So he cuddled her. He says, so Aisha, do you like this dua? She says, oh Prophet of Allah, and who wouldn't love such a beautiful dua? He says to her, by Allah, Aisha, this is the dua I make for every member of my ummah after every salah. After every salah, he made this dua for you and I, my brothers and sisters. Towards the end of his life, Sahaba, they seen actions in him, khalas, they sensed that he was leaving us. You know, have you ever seen someone who dies, or after someone dies, you start living back the last few weeks, you start picking up, wallahi, you know, he said things that, khalas, you know, Sahaba, they're seeing actions from him, they got the feeling, Rasulullah is leaving us now, khalas, Rasulullah is leaving. The hadith is authentic. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he walks into the Baqi'a, which is the cemetery right next to Masjid al-Nabawi. And Sahaba with you. And my brothers, again, I want you to imagine you're there. He walks into the Baqi'a and makes dua for the dead. Then he turns to the Sahaba and he says something interesting. He says, I long to see my brothers. So Sahaba, swear I long to see my brothers. They're looking at each other and they said, oh Prophet of Allah, aren't we your brothers? He says, no, you are my companions. You know, my brothers, this is my personal feelings, so this is my opinion and I'm entitled to it. My personal feelings when I read the hadith, wallahi, I say to myself, if I was a sahabi on that day, wallahi, I would have been boiling in anger and fury. What do you mean that I'm a sahabi and someone else is your brother? If you now, you and I, if you had the choice, would you be the sahabi of Rasulullah? Would you be his friend? Or do you want to be his brother? Which one do you want to be? Naturally, I would want to be his brother. So sahaba are amazed. What do you mean sahaba, we are your companions? So they asked, a Prophet of Allah, and who are these so-called brothers of yours? We are the sahaba. Who are your akhwan? They asked him, who are your so-called brothers? I can't help but feel, you know, that they were a little bit. He says, my brothers are those who will come after me. They will believe in me though they've never seen me. And one of them will give up everything he owns and all of his family members just to lay his eyes on me. I long to see my brothers. There's a big difference between if I can see him, I wish to see him, I would like to see him, and when I tell you, I long to see him. So one of the companions, he says, oh Prophet of Allah, again, I can't help but feel that he wasn't too happy about the situation. He says, oh Prophet of Allah, and how will you recognize these so-called brothers of yours? Nahna, we the Sahaba, you know us by face, by name, we lived with you, we fought with you, we bled with you, we laughed with you, we cried with you, we married, we divorced, we had children, you know us and we know you. But these so-called brothers of yours, how will you know them? How will you recognize them? Look at the analogy he gives. He says, if one of you had a black horse with a white face and white feet, and you lost this horse amongst a group of pure black horses, would Would you not be able to recognize which horse is yours? So they said, of course, Ya Rasulullah, my mine is the only one with the white face and white feet. He said, I will recognize my brothers like you recognize your horse. For the markings of the wudu that you make will be shining with nur on the day of judgment. Such a Nabi. Wallahi, such a Nabi, and so much love he had for this ummah. My brothers, forgive me. Wallahi, I've traveled almost 30 hours to be here. Forgive me if I take a few minutes beyond your time. Please, wallahi, and I'm sure you people have maximum akhlaq and manners. Wallahi, forgive you. Just a couple of minutes. The Prophet, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, every Prophet in dunya, every Prophet was given one wish, one dua in our modern, yani get out of jail free card. Anytime, any place, he puts it on the table with Allah, Allah answers. Nuh, when he put his card on the table, he said, oh Allah, destroy them. Allah sent rain from the heavens and from the earth. He left nothing behind.
You can tell the way he admires Muhammad by the way he's describing everything. In the first part, I forgot to talk about how Muhammad would go days maybe without food with the rest of his family. I mean, most people go through such things. Not all days were good for Muhammad. He also experienced bad times. He was experiencing things that normal people would do. That's why I said he never felt like he was above anyone else. And then he had such good attributes that in turn he attracted good people. And by good people, I'm talking about his wives. He's happy, they're happy, and they were thriving together, not one bringing the other person down. No, it was, I guess it wasn't like that. When she saw him smiling, she asked for him to make a prayer for her, and she was very much pleased with the prayer. This is the person that's praying for you, praying for your friends. Pray, it all means a lot to someone if you appreciate such kind of gestures. Let's get to the last part of this.